Our Defence Forces, of course, played a big part today. And on Friday, I spoke to the new Chief of the Defence Force, Air Marshal Kevin Short, about the day and the future for New Zealand's Defence Forces.
The commemoration is really about the high cost of war, that World War I was an incredible cost if you look at the number of men in particular, and there were some women who went to war, and the heavy losses. And I think if we look at subsequent conflicts, that huge loss is something that we need to remember. And we need to remember when we make decisions to deploy our young men and women in the Defence Force today. When I look forward, you know, wars are getting more complex. What you call the standard, who is the enemy? Traditional, if you like, defence force for a particular country, or are they insurgents within a country? And so the complexities are there. But technology keeps changing. And if there's one thing I must look at for our defence force is making sure that the technology we have to fight whatever conflict we are asked to go in, that we're agile enough and ready enough with the technologies that we can fight
with. Well, that's a good point. Do we have that technology? And I wonder if we could start with, say, cyber, which was identified, cyber warfare. What does that mean, and how much does it cost to have a cyber-equipped army going into the future?
Well, our Defence Force has been doing what used to be called electronic warfare and protection of our systems. The latest term for protecting our communication systems and computers is called cyber. So it's just a transition from what we were doing in old analog communication systems and protecting those to actually using software and computer systems. So we're not doing something what I call brand new, but the skills and experience and the technology are things that we're having
is
to learn.
Is it a defensive capability or is it an offensive capability as well?
Right now we're building a defensive capability so we can protect our systems. You know, we connect through our defence systems through to those suppliers internationally. We need to make sure we can protect the information flows to our suppliers. We also need to make sure that we can connect to our friends and allies and the coalition we might be operating with to make sure we keep ourselves safe, but also not risk the coalition we're fighting with or operating with.
You mentioned about the high cost of war with World War I and World War II, huge casualty rates. Do you see a future in which we still need to have combat-ready troops, or could we see more drones, more unmanned tanks, this sort of thing as we go forward?
I think we'll always have a defence force. The role of the defence force and the numbers that you need to win, because it is about winning, will change. Technology allows you to fight a conflict differently, whether it's with very complex RPAS, remotely piloted air systems. I'd rather call it that than drones. Drones gives an effect of a dumb.
But is that on your shopping list, drones? Would they be up there?
Well, RPAS, I'll call
RPAS
it RPAS.
Or whatever you want to
yes,
call them.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Absolutely. It's something that was on the previous capability plan for mid-2020s, and we're still looking at that technology. We'll never be what I call the leading edge. We're more of a technology follower. We've got to look at the size and cost of a defence force, and we've got to look at how we can interoperate with our friends and allies. So it's always going to be a balance.
It's interesting because we know the last government committed $20 billion, something similar presumably from this government, maybe not as much, but they have committed to the P-8s, the surveillance planes, which is a big cost, billions of dollars. Does that leave much left over for what you need?
Yes, it does, because that cost was planned. It was brought forward by a few years, admittedly, from the original plan we had, and that's because the production line timings meant we had to put an order in early. But that's $2.35 billion out of a $20 billion plan, and was budgeted with that cost. In fact, there's money available for what we call a complementary capability, which will support the P-8s. The P-8s are expensive. They're a very capable weapon system, and we want to complement that with something that goes beyond what they can do or is more effective.
That? Is that the underwater stuff?
No, it's more like, let's say, a small twin-engine aircraft that can do surveillance, RPAS, or satellite systems.
So space.
We're looking at that range of capabilities. It hasn't been decided yet, but that complementary bit means that you can use the P8 more effectively in what I'll call an intelligence-led process.
Sure. So that would be an investment in space military technology for New Zealand. Would that be our first?
We already have invested in space. We've invested in communication systems, satellite communication systems, so that we can guarantee that we can pass information to our men and women in the field, wherever they might be.
Interoperability is interesting. So the ability to work with our foreign partners, how much of the focus of the next few decades is going to be about Asia, and I'm thinking in particular the South China Sea. Is that a focus for our military now?
If I look at the policy statement, it really is about focusing in the South Pacific, that we've got to understand what is going on in our front yard, and that no matter where we deploy, we need to have the ability to do things alone initially. But if I look at history and you look at the size of our defence force, it would be very rare that we deploy and operate alone. Most of the time it's operating with friends and allies with similar aims. So for instance, Australia, we need to be able to deploy and operate with them as soon as we hit the ground, as it were.
Is China a defence partner?
We've got a defence relationship with them. We've actually got a 5-year plan that we look at how we will work together. We exercise with them. We have high-level strategic dialogue.
There's clearly a tension there, isn't there? Because the defence report talks about the spheres of influence, the great power. We know that the US and China are pushing for influence in our region. How much of a factor is that? I mean, you have hardened the language a little bit in that report about China.
So, but we still can operate together. The language has been accepted by, I'm going to say, both countries. We haven't stopped engaging. We, in fact, recently had one of the aircraft come down and operate in what is called SkyTrain. We have senior officers going to China to discuss military issues. We have discussions about how we can cooperate in the South Pacific.
But the tension must be that how do our Five Eyes partners view that relationship?
I think that you call it tension. I think we've got a reasonably competent process that we work with, and I'm speaking more with the military side. We do limit what we actually discuss with them, how you do humanitarian assistance, disaster relief, how you do peacekeeping, and they're a very large peacekeeping force at the moment. In fact, probably the second largest contributor, and how we do search and rescue. So we limit what we discuss and how we operate together, but we share information, we share the way we
sure.
can support each other.
What about, I wonder about the defence, looking forward, where do you think the Defence Force is in terms of its social licence with the public and in terms of its reputation? There have clearly been some issues around the hit and run book into Operation Burnham, and we now know there is an inquiry. Are you satisfied with the reputation of the Defence Force as a transparent, as an open organisation, that's something that the public can have faith and trust in?
Reputation is very important to us. I think that if you look at the values that we operate under, and we demonstrate that in the way we go about our business, so it is quite interesting when you look at the public, because I believe we engage with the public, the community, nation, world, construct.
So were you satisfied with the way in which the Defence Force responded to those allegations, separate to whether you agreed with them or not?
Mm.
The response, was that satisfactory?
There have been many messages over many years, so I would like to state that we've responded each time we've had questions from government about what occurred. Things unfolded as the news came back from Afghanistan. But I'm satisfied that we responded with the best information we had at the time, giving every piece of information we had to the government. The issues about changing stories and issues is more about the information flow and where that came from. I'm very satisfied that we have address that through this inquiry, that we are providing the data we have, the information we have. We will be calling witnesses, or they'll be calling witnesses, and we'll allow them to speak on there. I think we're contributing everything we can to support the inquiry. At the moment, I'm very comfortable that our men and women in theatre operated within the letter of the law.
Air Marshal Kevin Short there, Chief of the Defence Force. Now, our panel is here after the break. Professor Jennifer Curtin, Sir Don McKinnon and Anjan Rahman. I'll get a quick comment from Sir Don. Some interesting sort of angles there about the future for our defence forces. Do you think they've got the strategy right there going forward? It's going to be a different century, isn't it?
Well, it will be, and I'm particularly impressed by the number of New Zealanders who turned out to the armistice commemoration today all over the country. That's a good sign. And I'm going to add here the number of New Zealanders who turned up to that little town in France. The last battle of the New Zealand Division, Le Quenoir, was pretty good last weekend. I think Air Marshal Short has really summed it up pretty well. You know, we have really three essential requirements for our defence forces, and I'm not just saying the defence of the nation, but interoperability with our normal allies is certainly very important, and the ability to keep up with those people. Secondly, of course, is in the high tech field. You've got to be able to keep up with technology and defence, and of course it is expensive and doesn't get any cheaper, but if you want to be a player of significance, you've certainly got to be there. And thirdly, I think ensuring that our friends in the South Pacific, our home region, are comfortable that we are always going to be there to help, we're always going to be there to support them, that our defence strategy overall does include the whole of the Pacific region.